Good morning, Christ is in our midst. I'm Father Theophon Whitfield. We do have a few visitors with us today, Ian and Deborah, welcome. And it is my honor and privilege to introduce Father Chad Hatfield. Father Chad is now the president. The title changes here and there, but is the president of St. Vladimir's Orthodox Theological Seminary in Crestwood, New York, where he has served for some 10 years plus now. Before St. Vladimir's, Father Chad served as the Dean of St. Herman's Seminary in Kodiak, Alaska. He is a pastor with extensive experience, not only in seminaries, but also in mission communities, both in the States and internationally. Father Chad is a bright light in our effort to strengthen and multiply the presence of Orthodox Christianity in North America. Today, in these days before the Nativity of Christ, Father Chad will lead us in a series of reflections on Mary, mysteries, and mission. Father Chad, welcome once again to St. Nicholas.
Thank you. First of all, I want to congratulate all of you for the fact that you're here. Most of you could have awakened this morning and seen snow on the ground and said, well, that's that, and just rolled over and pulled the blankets up over your head. But you're here, and it's a great blessing for me to be here. This is not my first time here. I was thinking of a friend of mine who was ordained in the Church of England. And as you know, the Church of England is the state church, and being the state church, one of the things that happens to their clergy is they are assigned to do anybody and everybody's funerals, whether they have much of an association with the church or not. It is the duty of the state church to bury these people too. So my friend, who was newly ordained, was given his first assignment at the local cemetery and crematorium. And he was quite nervous about it, and the man who was overseeing things there took him to the podium like this and explained to him that if it was to be an in-ground burial, that he was to push the top button, and that would be the cue that would signal the six pallbearers, and the six pallbearers would come down the aisle and pick up the casket and escort it out for ground burial. If it was to be a cremation, then he was to push the bottom button, and that would signal the people in the back, and the curtain would open up, and the pulleys would take the casket behind the curtains and close, and that would conclude the service. So my friend concluded the Anglican burial office. He pushed the button, and six pallbearers presented themselves, and the pulley cranked up and took the casket behind the curtains and closed. And there were six pallbearers in front of him looking quite confused. He was confused. He had no idea what to do. And suddenly a voice from behind the curtain, a very cockney voice, said, "If you want him back, push the middle button." Well, that's what Father Theophan has done. He pushed the middle button to bring me back. I think it's been 6 years.
Since it's been six years, yeah.
Which is embarrassing, actually. But I know that's how it goes. And you know, part of what I do at the seminary, besides being an evil administrator, is teaching courses in mission and evangelization. And my favorite course is one I'll be doing, you know, this coming spring, which is a parish administration course for the seniors. I like it because in the spring, you know, they're all thinking about where they're going once after there is life after seminary. So that's actually become my favorite course. I can't leave it alone. Every year there's something that, you know, I have to make an adjustment to. And this year it happened to be just on the topic of priesthood, because one of the seminarians pointed out to me that neither St. Tikhon Seminary in Pennsylvania nor St. Vladimir's, our seminary, offers a single course specifically in priesthood. And since we're there training men for the priesthood, that did seem a little bit odd. So I've had to kind of adjust the curriculum to put a few things in there. But when I'm out like this, that's my reward for life in the seminary, because I get to see our graduates and their wives and their kids, you know, on the ground doing what they do. So particularly in this case, you know, I get to actually see it with a change over a period of time. And that's exciting, because I congratulated you that you came out today for a little time for an Advent retreat. And we have to remember that as Orthodox Christians here in North America, we're about 1% of the U.S. population. We're a tiny, tiny minority group. There was a period, not so very long ago, when we were certainly a growing minority group. In the 1980s and the 1990s, it was quite common to see entire congregations from other Christian traditions embracing Orthodoxy, bringing their pastor and clergy along and all of that. That doesn't happen now. I'm hard-pressed to think of a single example from the last 10 years of that happening. We can ponder the whys and wherefores of all of that, but the truth of the matter is that we Orthodox have got to recommit ourselves to what it means to be a missional church. We have to recommit individually and corporately to fulfilling what is called the Great Commission. And that's where our Lord says that we are to go forth and baptize all nations in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We know what that means. But sometimes we Orthodox can become so incredibly comfortable with where we are that we forget that there's a wide swath of the population that are actually looking for the treasure that we have. And we find ourselves guilty of being what we also see in the scriptures, of hiding the light of Christ under the bushel basket. People can't find us. So that's why something like this is important. You may look around and say, well, I wish there were 50 people in here, or 60 people, or 100 people. You know, well, you know what? We thank God that you're here today. You're, as I said, you're the people that got out and saw the snow today. And you came. You determined to come. Others were wanting to be with us today, but they live far away. That's another reality of being Orthodox here in North America. I just discovered that one of us here today was born in Salina, Kansas, and I'm the founding priest of Orthodoxy in Salina, Kansas. I'll have to tell you a quick side story there. All of my students, by the way, at the seminary say that they love having classes with Father Chad because it's like story time with the old man. So that's great. I think trigger story time, but when we started the Orthodox mission in Salina, Kansas, if you don't know where Salina, Kansas is, you look at the lower 48 states and you make the sign of the cross over, okay? Well, where the bars intersect, that's Salina, Kansas, okay? It's right on the edge of western Kansas, and if you've ever been there, you know that that's where you see more and more, less and less than any place in America, you know? So instruction from the Antiochian Archdiocese on how to get a name for the church there. And so all of my Antiochian brothers told me, okay, this is what you do, Father Chen. They're going to ask you to submit three names. So make sure that you put St. George as your first choice, because there are so many St. George churches, the Metropolitan won't pick that name. And then pick St. Mary as your second choice, because there are so many St. Marys, so you won't pick that one either. And then the third one is the one that you really want. Okay? So I followed the instructions. And then the letter came, and I didn't get any of the above. The letter from Metropolitan Philip said that you will be all saints. That if Orthodoxy is to survive in a place like Salina, Kansas, you don't need a patron, or two patrons, or three patrons. You need the entire company of heaven interceding for you. And so you will be all saints. Okay? So that's just part of, you know, again, a little sidebar story of what it's like. But I had people in that parish who drove over 100 miles to get to a church, because they're there. We have people who live in Rocky Ford, Colorado here. You have to drive how far to cover?
About 50 miles or so.
Yeah, so we're used to distances and those kinds of things, okay? But what we have here this morning is what I call the faithful remnant. You know, you're the people who recognize in your own spiritual life, you're willing to set aside a little bit of a day in a very busy, hectic time culturally, just before Christmas, to be quiet and present before the Lord. To be reflective. What it means to actually hear the voice of the Lord. I used to be a priest in Africa. for 5 years. Again, it's a place that I love and I miss. But one of the things that would often happen, particularly when I was in referred to there as the bush, it would not be unusual for an African to tell me about a conversation they had with God or with a saint or with an angel. That was just sort of how it is. You know, being a priest here in the U.S., when a parishioner comes in to say, an archangel was speaking to me the other day, you know, you immediately look for the referral, or you're going to get this person some help, because we think that they're mentally imbalanced. It's not unusual in Africa, and it's usually done with such great joy that everybody else gets happy to hear what it was that the archangel said. But I thought about that much in my life, and I think one of the differences is, particularly in the bush in Africa, the world is so incredibly quiet. It's one of those places where it's quiet enough that it actually hurts your ears. It's that quiet. And you know what? If your interior life is prepared for it, you could hear an archangel or a saint whisper in your ear. But let's think about our lives and our culture here in America. We are surrounded by noise at every single turn. And even when we have an opportunity for quiet, we make noise. You know, we've got something plugged into our ears or something, you know, all the time. So, you know, we can't even mow the lawn without things plugged into our ears. That's how we are. So I think that even if our guardian angel decided to whisper in our ear, we're probably too busy to hear. And that's why we have to force ourselves to make time to go into retreat. Now, this is the other thing that's so difficult for us. You and I are high-powered people. We're high-octane Americans, so we're busy. If someone asks an American if they can see you, we have to get out our phone to check the calendar to see where we might find a slot. We live in a culture now in which people have never been so lonely, never been so depressed, and yet we've never lived in a time which there are more incredible ways of communicating with people. I have 3 grandchildren in Texas, and when I'm there, it's always amazing for me to watch them. They're texting each other in the house. They're sitting on the couch, glued, but they're still communicating this way. Well, that's our culture. So it's a real struggle for us to find quiet time. Now, I know that, I believe it's Ann Wilkins has a connection here.
We know Ann Wilkinson.
Wilkinson.
Our family does.
Okay. Well, that's a conversation that we had since I've been here. She must be the niece of Mother Rafaela.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't know how many of you know Mother Rafaela with the community of the Myrrh-Bearing Women in Otago, New York. She and I have a lot in common, and she and I have talked about what I'm presenting to you right now. She and I both grew up as High Church Episcopalians. We were the type of Episcopalian that you know, could get a nosebleed if the mass was so high on Sunday morning. You know, that's our culture. That's our ethnic identity, I guess you could say. I became an Episcopal priest, and she became an Episcopalian nun. We both then made our way to Orthodoxy. But we have talked about the fact that as Anglo-Catholics in particular, we knew how to be quiet. It was not unusual for us to enter into a 3-day silent retreat. That was very common in our spiritual life. Well, you try getting Orthodox people to be quiet for 3 days. It's impossible. Absolutely impossible. And what's odd about that is we're people who write great books and other such things about the quietness of the heart, the quietness of the interior life. We're the noisiest bunch of people I've ever seen. The other thing that Mother Rafaela and I have commented on is that something will be booked as a retreat. It's not. It's what we would call a workshop. You're busy. You know, again, we're this high-octane people. We've got to be doing something. Now, I've been told by some of my brother priests that that's because we live so far apart from each other that when we do get together, we're sort of using the time to catch up. Okay, that's fair enough. I should also point out that Mother Rafaela has Kansas farm roots, and I have Kansas farm roots. So that was another thing that we have in common. So, having made that observation, what I'm doing, by the way, is I'm laying the foundation for the rest of the day, which is very, very important. That's to acknowledge that you've made the commitment to be here to listen to the voice of the Lord, to be quiet. And even if whatever I say today is meaningless and there's nothing that resonates with you, I like to remind people that the Lord was able to make Balaam's ass to speak and to be useful, okay? So that's how it is. There is a great blessing waiting for each and every one of you here today. And that means that the evil one, who never sleeps, and he fasts better than we do because he never eats, is aware of the fact that you made a decision today to be here to draw closer to the Lord in this final period of the Nativity fast in preparation for the celebration of our Lord's Nativity. And he hates that. So he will do everything he can to distract you, to put your mind somewhere else, to put the focus elsewhere. One of the things that my father confessor likes to remind me often is the devil has ears, you know, so he hears. So what I ask you to do today as we sort of enter into this period of retreat is to look around who's here today and find another person that you know their Christian name and take that name and tuck it into your heart and commit yourself to praying for that person today. That whatever it is that is the hidden blessing that the Lord is ready to deliver to you as a sort of Christmas package, Christmas gift, that will be made known and revealed to them. That's very, very important today, that we enter into that spirit of quiet prayer with another person. So whatever comes forth from the blessing of this retreat can be revealed to them. So that's a deal?
Deal.
Okay, so you kind of look around and find that person, and nobody's going to be left out, because if someone isn't chosen, I guarantee you that your guardian angel is going to be there on your behalf. Okay, we're good? Bring this thing out. See where we are. All right. So, when Father Theophan was kind enough to invite me back to do this today, we talked about, you know, well, what can we find that would be an appropriate theme for Advent? It seemed to me that a good thing would be to look at Christian basics. And the best way to do that, I think, is what I call the M&Ms. We could have had M&Ms today, I guess, right? As he said in the introduction, this has to do with a focus on Mary and mysteries and mission. Because when you actually think about Orthodox Christianity, that's really where it is. There's the fact that we as Orthodox Christians recognize that ours is an incarnate Lord. O come, Emmanuel. God is with us. That lies at the heart of what it means to be an Orthodox Christian. Ours is not a distant God. Ours is not a vengeful God. Ours is a God who loves us so much that he has entered into our realm, that he has made himself vulnerable. When we look at the icon of the Christ child in the cave at the Nativity, what can be more vulnerable than that newborn babe? There he is. Ours is a God who seeks us out. In a few moments, I'm going to take you to the opening pages of Genesis. But before I take you to Genesis, I want you to recognize that the very first evangelistic words that we find in Scripture come from God himself when he calls out to Adam and Eve, "Where are you?" That's classic evangelization. It is God calling to you and to me. And he's asking the question, "Where are you?" We're the ones who were lost. Someone said earlier this morning they like living in the Bible Belt. That was you all, right? Yes. Yeah, I don't like the Bible Belt. I was born only 2 miles from the Kansas-Oklahoma border. And Oklahoma would certainly claim to be the buckle of the Bible Belt, right? You know? Well, I used to amuse myself when I was a kid reading bumper stickers on cars in Oklahoma. I was there recently. They still have lots of bumper stickers on the cars. But my favorite one was, "Have you found Jesus?" You know, because it was pointed out to me by my priest growing up, guess what? He's not lost. You are. And the important thing is, He has found us. So when we're looking at the basics of our Christian identity, it is the recognition that ours is a God who comes seeking you and me. And so we're going to look at how that came into being. So incarnational theology. And then secondly, there are what we call the mysteries in Orthodox Christianity. We struggle as Orthodox Christians living in the West to make ourselves understood. And I think for the most part, we have passed through an era of our history where we sort of strained to blend in. We were self-conscious about being different. I think we've gotten over that. I think we're now at a stage in which we're discovering it's pretty cool to be different, and that we actually have something to offer that is different. So a lot of our terminology, we ended up trying to communicate in the West. We went to away from Greek-based terminology to Latin-based terminology. So those of you that are cradle-born Orthodox know you probably grew up talking about the sacraments, okay? Sacramentum, Latin-based. That's how we could be understood. But for us, it's really mysterium, Greek, and for an English term, we call them the mysteries. So the mysteries, again, are part of what it means to be incarnational. The fact that God has come among us means that matter matters. In much of the Protestant world, matter is the source of sin and evil, okay? The Bible Belt. Ask them, what is sin? Well, they'll give you a laundry list. Well, it's dancing, it's drinking, it's card playing, it's all those things. For us, we recognize that sin is not in external things. The sin lies where? It's in us, okay? We're what needs to be cleansed, healed, redeemed, saved. So, our understanding of sin, again, is not something external, but we recognize that it is through the things external that salvation comes to us. So, we have bread, wine, we have water, we have oil, we have visible things that communicate to us God's love, and the power and presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. God is active among us. He hasn't deserted us. We aren't deists in which He sort of made a clock, wound it up, but He's out there somewhere. No, again, He's here. He is present among us. So we'll look at what it means to be Christians who surround ourselves and are active through the so-called mysteries of the church. And the third great M, of course, is the mission of the church. We are called to be His hands, His feet, His voice, His presence here and now. There's another thing which is so significant for us as Orthodox Christians, and if you think, I like that guy Father Theophan brought from New York because he was critical of other Christian traditions. I'm not being critical. I'm trying to show you your own tradition and give a better appreciation for that. So if I draw a comparison or something, I'm doing that not in a critical way, but just as a kind of factual way. Much of Protestant Christianity still has the kingdom coming. Okay? The kingdom is out there somewhere, and you know that's a goal to get to it, kind of like you know shooting a space rocket or something. You know, we hope to eventually get there. That is not how we Orthodox Christians understand the kingdom. We understand that the kingdom is here and now, and that we are in fact living in the kingdom here and now. We recognize that we are citizens passing through this place. That ours is a higher kingdom to which we are called. Okay, we're good with that. But that means that we have to live lives that reflect the reality that we live in the kingdom present now, and we have to show others that the kingdom is here. So that's the sharing of what we call the good news. All right? So that kind of lays a bit of a foundation for where we want to go today. Right? Okay, you're good? All right. We're good. So as promised, to get to an understanding of Mary and her role in the economy of our salvation, and that's a very important phrase that I just used, her role in the economy of our salvation. Got it? Let that sink in. It has to return to the opening pages of Scripture. Okay? Now that gets dangerous, because sometimes, you know, when we start talking about Genesis, people get all sidetracked, like with the Scopes trial in Tennessee, and evolution, and all those other kinds of things, okay? I'm happy to take that up, but not today, all right? What I want you to do today is just simply appreciate the opening pages of our scripture in maybe a different way than you have understood them before. I'm not going to read to you the opening pages of scripture. I could do that, but you basically know them. That's a portion of scripture that people know. Now, again, I don't mean this in a critical way. I just mean to point this out. If you really want to short-circuit what we would call a fundamentalist Protestant, just simply mention the two creation narratives in the opening pages of Genesis, okay? It does not compute, okay? They cannot grasp that. How can there be two? But there are two. All you have to do is open up your Bible and have a look. The first creation narrative, which runs through the opening verses, through Genesis 2:2, okay, that's one creation narrative. Then a second one comes immediately after that. Does that mean that the Bible is full of lies? Not at all. What it means is this is so important and so significant that it's told to us in two different narratives, saying the same thing. Okay? So just relax with that. Okay? You're fine. All right? In the opening creation narrative we have in the book of Genesis. This is a sort of interesting parallel for everybody that gets all wound up with various evolutionary conversations and whatever. This is primitive, ancient Hebrew text. But it runs almost identically parallel with what science tells us is the order for which things came into being. It's pre-science, folks, but in fact, it runs almost parallel. Because the opening pages, we are told that in the beginning there was nothing, okay? And God begins to create out of nothingness. Now that's important for us. Ex nihilo is an important phrase for us. There was nothing, okay, except God. And he begins to create out of the nothingness. So we're told in the opening pages of Genesis that the breath of God, the wind of God, begins to move across the face of the earth. Okay? I'm gonna do something, okay? I've got a Hebrew scholar here with me today. Well, to show you we're all fair. If you're left-handed, use your left hand, if not, use your right hand, okay? So put your hand in front of your face. Okay. We're gonna learn a little Hebrew here, all right? Now, I want you to pretend that you were in an Italian restaurant last night and you just had an overabundance of garlic, so you've got really garlicky breath, okay? And just repeat the word ruach.
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 You're not breathy enough. Remember the garlic. One more time. Ruach. So what did you feel?
In spirit.
Yeah? So what did you feel?
Heat, warmth.
Okay. I got heat, warmth over here. Okay? Now the wonderful thing about the Hebrew language is it's like watching a movie, you know? It's much more alive and colorful than the English language, okay? So when you're speaking Hebrew, it's like watching a movie. So you get a fuller kind of picture of things. So if something does not have warmth, is what?
Dead,
okay? So it is a way of showing life. Now, he felt warmth. What else did you feel? Breath, wind, okay? You use the term spirit, okay? Spirit, wind. So this breath of God is moving and beginning to create in Genesis. Okay? Moving. And you get the feel for what this means. The whole breath of God bringing forth creation from nothing. In the Hebrew language, if you did not have the warmth, you did not have the wind, the breath of God within you, you are dead. So it is a way of showing that God brings forth life. Life from nothingness. And through the darkness, we see the separation of light from the darkness, and we begin to see an order coming into being. Okay? So there are the waters that cover the face of the earth. There's the basic life sources that we find in water, okay? And it begins to move up the ladder. And eventually, you see at the end of that creation narrative that God creates man. All right? Is Adam and Eve named in that creation narrative? They're not named, okay? The point of that creation narrative is that mankind, humanity, is at the top of the created order. So that's what that portion of scripture is telling you and me. We're at the top of the game, all right? Then we have a second creation narrative. It's in a reverse order, okay? I love the second one because it's so anthropomorphic. It's got God playing in the mud. And those of us that are parents, every single one of you, I guarantee, those of us who are parents have at some point been holding the hand of your child and there is a puddle, and before you can say, don't, the kid has jumped in the puddle, okay? There's something about us that we like that, okay? Because God, out of the mud, begins to form the man, okay? Now again, what does science tell us about this magnificent body? Well, some are more magnificent than others, I guess. You know, it is a magnificent thing, the human body, okay? So what does science tell us about this body? What's it made of? Someone said it.
Carbon.
Okay, earth? Yeah, okay. What's the biggest portion of all this?
Water,
H2O, about 85%, something like that, you'd say, okay? Maybe higher for some people, less for some people. But anyway, that's a good range for us. And then, as Machishka said, you know, we're basic carbons of the universe, okay? We're dirt, okay? So that gives us an identity of who we are. We're dirt, okay? We're taken from the earth, and we're reminded that you know, we will return to the earth from which we were taken. That's also revealed to us in the pages of Genesis, all right? So out of pretty basic stuff, God has created humanity. And the other thing that is revealed to us in the book of Genesis is the fact that we were made in His image and likeness. And there is no other creature like that. So we have God playing in the mud. And He forms the man, okay? Adam. So this is a very inclusive name. So when we're reading the second creation narrative, it's not a story about a man named Adam and a woman named Eve. It is your story and my story. This is where God reveals to us through Scripture our basic identity. We discover who we are in this story. So this is our story, okay? This is about you and me that we're reading about in that second creation narrative. So the man is created, God breathes the breath of life into him, and we're told, God says, it's not good that he's alone, okay? So God begins to create, and to show again the dominance of man, the superior place in the created order of the one creature created in the image and likeness of God. He demonstrates this by naming. Okay? By naming, it means he is in control. You are. So we see this is the sort of Hatfield paraphrase version of the Bible. But you have the man Adam, and he's named. That's a giraffe. That's a rhinoceros. That's a cockroach. You know, flea. Goes on down the line. But you can see that God is not quite getting the job done. Not so good. Okay. So he has a deep sleep falling to the man, and we're told that from the man's very substance, i.e. the rib taken, in other words, it's emphasizing from the same source, same being, same matter, comes forth the woman from the womb, Eva, the mother of all living, we're told. Okay? This is our mother, the mother of all of humanity. And Again, this is the Hatfield paraphrased version of the Bible. When the man is awakened from his deep sleep, the response is, "Ah, this is a whole lot better than the hippopotamus that went trotting past before I took the nap." This is how it is intended to be. The harmony, the complementarian way between man and woman in creation. It's there. This is how it was intended to be. Now, this is also important because remember, we're looking at Mary and her role in the economy of salvation. So the man and the woman, Adam and Eve, are living in paradise. Things are good. What's the one rule that they have? They just have one rule. Yes? Do not eat from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now this is an interesting thing that we glean from the fathers of the church. Many of the fathers of the church tell us that Adam and Eve were created as teenagers. Now again, those of us that have survived being parents of teenagers, what the heck, we survived our own life being teenagers, we recognize that a teenager is basically an adult, except they're still learning the consequences of choices. And that's part of being a teenager, learning that choices have consequences, good and bad, okay? There are results from choices that we make, particularly if the choice is made in an act of rebellion, a sense of my own independence. I am who I am, you know, I don't need you. Yes, I can still remember my younger brother saying to me, "You're not the boss of me," okay? I remind him of that once in a while. That was one of his favorite phrases. And I'm 6 years older, so I was old enough to really be able to corral that. That's kind of how we are with God. It's like, you're not the boss of me. Don't tell me what to do. Don't put these restrictions on me. Even if they're for my own good, I don't need that. Okay? I'm my own person. So, in Genesis, we recognize that there is a certain jealousy to be found in creation. And we see this in the serpent. The serpent who tempts our first mother Eve with conversation. And the fact that she beholds the tree and the fruit on the tree. And we're told in Genesis that it was pleasant to behold. In other words, it looked good. Now she knew that was one place you don't go in the Garden of Paradise, but you can hear the voice of the serpent speaking to her. You know he loved you best. Those of you that are old like me can remember the Smothers Brothers. Mom loved you best, didn't you? You know he loves you best. Go ahead. Then you will be like him. And you will have no need for him. That's the great lie of the evil one to humanity. Go ahead. Partake of that which is forbidden to you. Why was it forbidden? It was forbidden for one reason. They were not mature enough to handle the knowledge of good and evil. They weren't prepared for it yet. That happens to us as Orthodox Christians. We have different levels of maturity. St. Paul said, sometimes we're ready for meat, but often we're on pabulum and milk. That's where we are. One of the things I learned as a parish priest with particularly really zealous new converts was to make sure you take it easy. You don't eat the whole pie at once. And for those of us that are cradle-born Christians, Orthodox Christians, we have to remember the same thing. Sometimes you are at different stages. It's like in marriage. You know, I remember one priest saying, he always told couples in pre-marriage counseling that it's a 50-50 deal. And, you know, after being married for a while, I thought, 50-50, heck, it's sometimes like 90-10. One time, one partner's giving a whole lot more than the other one. Well, that's how it is in our spiritual life. Sometimes there's more there than others. We all have valleys that we pass through. So we have Eve here at the tree, and she makes the choice. She makes the decision. And she partakes of that which is forbidden to her. Go ahead. You will be like him and have no need for him. Now, she takes the fruit, of course, to Adam. Now, this again is the Hatfield paraphrase version of the Bible. He doesn't say, Eve, for God's sakes, take it back. No, it's more like, thanks very much, you've done the dirty work, I'll have my bite too. Well, what do Adam and Eve discover about themselves?
They're naked.
Their nakedness. In other words, they discover they're not much. Okay? They are basic carbons of the universe in H2O. They are not so special. Right? Now, again, the fathers tell us there was no need for clothes because they reflected the light and glory of God himself. The doxa, the glory of God. That's what clothed them. But that was diminished in their disobedience. That's how it is for you and for me. We bear the light of Christ into the world, but that light diminishes us because of sin. Our interior life becomes darkened because of sin. That's why we come to confession, to second baptism, for that time of absolute renewal and cleansing. But sometimes we can be so content that we prefer the darkness. We like it. We think we can hide. So God, again, wonderful anthropomorphic. Beautiful image put before us. It's walking in the garden, and he's calling out, where are you? We're hiding. Why are you hiding? Because we're naked. Who told you you were naked? And then we see the whole collapse. In creation, it was intended to be harmonious, paradise. So we see the collapse begin, what we call the fall. The man says, the woman you gave me, she made me do it. So the perfect relationship between man and woman, that perfection that we saw in those texts in Genesis, is fractured. It's broken. Okay? Eve. Well, the serpent, he beguiled me. The relationship between humanity and the created order is fractured, broken. The relationship between God and humanity is broken. The order for creation was intended to be that God comes first, that everything is centered around God. Well, the truth of the matter is, post-fall, everything is centered around you and me. We're self-absorbed, and we're struggling with creation. I mean, just be honest with yourself and ask, how much of your 24-hour day is spent being focused upon God? Not much. And that's the result of the fall, in which we're told again in Genesis, we're going to have to labor hard just for our existence, just to simply be. We were intended for what in creation? For perfect union with our Creator. And that access to the union is broken. I think one of the most powerful images that we hear in our liturgical year as Orthodox Christians is the expulsion of Adam and Eve from the garden. I've been in some churches where they have nice things on the wall, you know. They're not necessarily icons, they're just sort of, you know, murals maybe that kind of tell biblical stories. But I've seen some that are so incredibly powerful. It's like, you know, the hand of God with the finger of Adam and Eve looking back. They know what they have lost. Powerful. At that same time, as we're preparing to enter into Great Lent, we every year hear about the prodigal son, right? And you know in the text, and it's very clear in the Greek text, where it says that the prodigal was feeding the pods to the pigs, and it says he came to his senses. That's the general way that it's translated into English. What's it really saying? It's saying he remembered what he had. He remembered for what he was created to be, and in disobedience through sin, sin entered into the world, and therefore death, it was gone. Each one of us are prodigals, and like the prodigal son that we read about in Scripture, each of us, deep in our interior, have an understanding of what it is that we lost. Paradise lost. We had something, and it's no longer there, and we search for it. St. Augustine said, each one of us is born with a God-shaped void in our lives, and we spend our life trying to fill it with everything but God. So that's why you and I have taken a little bit of time here. That's why God has created the Sabbath. The Sabbath is created so we can have some time to do what we say in the liturgy, to lay aside all earthly cares, to give a tithe of our week, a tithe of our offering, a great Lent in the spring. What is that? It's a tithe of our year in which we intensify our longing to retrieve that which was lost. And the promise of God in Genesis is that He will not leave us in that state. They're expelled from paradise. The gate closes. Okay? The gate closes. I'm going to ask a question. Oh my gosh, here we go. See, you shouldn't reveal your identity to me, right? Jews have one day a year where the gate is open, right? For us, how many? What does it take to open the gate?
Repentance.
The act of repentance is the key that opens the gate every time. Through sin, the gate closes. Through repentance, the gate is open, and we have access to God. That's why in our Orthodox Christian life, we hear so much the term living a life of repentance. That doesn't mean that we're beating ourselves to death all the time because we're bad. It means that through repentance, we seek God. We seek to be cleansed. We seek to be healed and to be made whole so that we can be what we were intended to be in creation. You'll often hear some Protestant Christians being critical of us because we Orthodox Christians are generally hesitant to be confident about our salvation. I'm saved. I'm confident. I'm going to heaven. Okay? They've got bumper stickers in Oklahoma that say, glory bound. You know, that's what that means. We operate a little bit differently. It isn't that we doubt the action of God, for God has come, He has acted, the path to salvation is available to us. But we operate with this mentality. We call no one holy until they have drawn their last breath. Because in this life, there's a constant turning away from God. There's always the act of apostasy. That's the struggle that you and I have. It's Eve standing at the tree and being tempted and willfully doing that which we do separates us from the love of God. But that key, repentance, is always there. The gate is thrown open. And who's there to receive us when the gate is open? It is the vision of the incarnate Lord Himself. It is God who has acted. We drive this home, again, so beautifully in Orthodox Christianity. We're people who fast, right? We do that. Yes, I made my confession last night to my prescriptor. I'm so tired of this fast already, you know. I'm counting the days. This is the hardest fast for me. This one's tough. You know, some others are a little easier. This one's tough. Because the whole culture that surrounds me isn't there. You know, Caesar is having a great party at the moment. And here we are. But we don't fast to punish ourselves. We fast in order to hunger for God. So that's a good thing. That's my own passions that keep me from transforming my, oh, I can hardly look at another shrimp. somebody else identified with that. With a real hunger for God. So, this is where we see the place of Mary coming into play in the economy of our salvation. Eve is our first mother, and through her comes death into the world. Sin and death enter through her disobedience. We recognize that in Mary, this young Hebrew girl, through her act of obedience, and contrary to Eve's disobedience, brings us not death, but she brings us forgiveness and salvation. That's the difference. She is the new Eve. She is Eve perfected. She is Eve in the sense of being the true mother of all living. And this is so incredible when you look at the story. When you're reading in Luke about the young girl who's at the spinning wheel and the archangel Gabriel appears, you know, what is that like? Well, there's a sense, again, this is the Hatfield paraphrase version of the Bible. There's almost like a big wow. It's like, how can this be? Okay? When it is announced, you shall bear a child. His name shall be Emmanuel, God with us. But as it unfolds, what do we see? As with Eve, we saw the reverse. Moving away from God. With Mary, we see the movement is towards God. It concludes with, be it unto me according to your will. I am the handmaid of the Lord. So this is where we are in terms of this first big M. We recognize her place. My parents converted to Orthodoxy when they were in their mid-70s. And they were 90 miles from the nearest Orthodox church. And by golly, they did it. You know, in their mid-70s, they embraced everything fully. I still laugh when I hear, you know, the voice of my mom, you know, telling me the first time that she ever cooked with tofu. And my good Kansas farmer dad had his first bite of tofu, and it was like, what is this? You know? She was learning how to cook during the fast. But one of the things that I remember, you know, from my mother is when the Passion of Christ movie, Mel Gibson's movie, was, you know, out on the big screen and people were all talking about it. I was living in Alaska and I called my mom and my youngest son had actually taken her to see the movie. And I said, what did you think? Because at that point I hadn't seen it. And she said, for her, the most fascinating thing was the movement of Mary through the streets. Always a counter to the devil. Whenever the devil would appear, there was then Mary that sort of overshadowed and countered. It's like checkmate. Whatever move the devil made, Mary was there to counter it. Well, that's really how it is. The devil gave it his best shot, and it wasn't good enough. This is why at Pascha we rejoice. We rejoice when we hear those words. Hell took a man. And founded it. God. And I got a tummy ache. Got a belly ache. So again, we see the beautiful vision of the gates being broken. The gates that kept us from access to God are broken. And how are they broken? They're broken because Mary said yes. So as Orthodox Christians, we live a very balanced life in our relationship with the Mother of God. And I can do it. Well, thank God. You're right. Some churches live it kind of quite well. You got it right. We enter into an Orthodox temple. This is a way to demonstrate how balanced we are in our understanding of the Theotokos, the Mother of God, and the Savior. Because as Mary is the new Eve, so Jesus is the new Adam. He is the new man who conquers death. Adam is taken by death. Christ breaks it. He breaks the ancient enemy, trampling down death by death. So you and I enter into a temple. Okay? Now, forgive me if this offends you, but I'm trying to make it clear. For much of the Protestant Christian world, their best relationship with Mary comes maybe on a Christmas card. Okay? Other than that, not too much relationship, right? Often in a Roman Catholic world, there is another imbalance. You see her standing alone, almost to the point of being goddess herself. John Paul II was very keen about the concept in Roman Catholicism about Mary as co-redemptress. Okay? There was a point where he was contemplating that as possible new doctrine. It was the Orthodox world that said, do that and we'll never have a cup of tea with you again. Okay? It was that strong. Why? Because we understand the necessity of not being too far here or too far here, so we enter into our temples. What do we see on the Anastasia? We see our balance. Mary, the Theotokos, you see the color of her undergarment? What color is it?
Red.
And the undergarment?
Blue.
Okay? That's the sign of her humanity in iconography. Blue is a color for humanity. What's the outer garment?
Red,
which is the color for divinity. So divinity has covered her humanity. Okay? You see it. You move over to the Savior. What do you see in the undergarment?
Red.
It is red. It is divinity. And the outer garment? Is blue. God became man. Okay? So we're balanced. This is what we see when we enter into a temple. We recognize, even through the two primary icons in every Orthodox Christian temple, this kind of balance and reality of our salvation. We are reminded of that union between that which is divine and that which is humanity. And, as I've said before, the reason that we were created was for what? Perfect communion with God. All right, okay, we're getting to the close of this one. This kind of will overlap a little bit with the second one. But this kind of laid this foundation. Not so common in Slavic-based Orthodox churches, but in Byzantine-based Orthodox churches, the preparation of the Discos is being done, the Discos and the Chalice for the celebration of Divine Liturgy, you know that the Discos is basically construction of the church. That's what we have, centered around the Lamb, who is Jesus Christ. We've got the Theotokos there, and the saints, and all the rest, and then we get put in there, too. But the most common icon overseeing the proskuneo table in Byzantine churches is the Nativity. That's not always true in Slavic churches, and in the actual preparation of the gifts in the Byzantine Rite, there is a prayer that's often missing in Slavic books, which is a prayer directed to for O Bethlehem, prepare. The tree of Ephratah has blossomed forth with the fruit. In other words, from the Virgin has come the Savior. All right? In Hebrew, the word Bethlehem means what?
House of bread.
Bread. It's house of bread. Okay? So the word incarnate, of course, is born in the house of bread. So it is out of this very basic substance again, which is bread, that God comes to us. So there is this connection between incarnation and the mysteries, which we'll see in the next session here. But that also is part of the balance of our Orthodox Christian life. We recognize the truths of what Scripture reveals to us about how God comes to us and acts among us. In the Divine Liturgy, when we hear the word, with fear of God and faith and love draw near, what does that mean to you when you hear that word? Does it mean you're afraid of God?
The
awesomeness of God, okay. What's so awesome about our God? What's so awesome about our God?
He's too big to know that he's can't fathom.
Yes, so too big for us to fathom, right? That's a nice way to put it, actually. Yeah. We are incapable of knowing God, and yet he reveals himself to us fully in the word incarnate, in Logos. So we can know the Savior. There are basically three ways to know the body of Christ that's revealed to us in Scripture. Do you know what the three ways are? There is first the Word incarnate, born of the Virgin Mary. When we recite our profession of faith in the Nicene Creed, that Word incarnate is where? The right hand of the Father. Come the judgment day, we will stand before the throne. We will know the Word incarnate in that way. Second, it's in the bread, come down from heaven. He who eats of this bread will live forever. So there is the second way. The third way, Scripture reveals to us that it is in the church that we encounter and know the body of Christ. And that ties into the third of the three M's that we will hear today. So I've talked a lot. We're going to break for lunch at 1. Is that right?
We will break for lunch at 1. And
so one of the things that I'll do now, because I love the Whitfields, and I don't want to leave any mess for them. You know, let's face it, I'm a visiting fireman. I blow in here and I blow out. So if I create a mess, it gets left for the Whitfields to work out, right? Okay. So I hope not to leave any messes. So if I've created any messes or confusions or other kinds of things, or maybe you have some other kind of comments, we could maybe take them now before we break for lunch so I can try to clean up any messes. Yeah.
It is an interesting image that you showed